Hello, everyone. I'm Ross Kemmage from the University of Colorado, and welcome to this expert panel discussion on ALK-positive non-small cell lung cancer. I'm joined by two very special guests today. Rosario, could you introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi, Ross. Happy to be here with all of you. My name is Rosario García Campelo, medical oncologist in the University Hospital of La Coruña in the northwest of Spain. It's a great pleasure.
Great. And Charlie, could you introduce yourself?
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so my name is Yongchang Zhang. So, you know, I'm from China. So I focus on the target and immune therapy of lung cancer. I have my own living tissue bank. So just okay. Thank you, Ross.
All right. So let's start. So here we are. So we've got people from North America, people from Europe, people from Asia, and yet we all represent our own individual centers. But I'm going to start with a question. And Rosario, I'm going to start with you. How do you do ALK testing? Who do you do it in? And when do you do it? And describe your own center and perhaps your neighbors as well.
So we are doing ALK testing for all those advanced non-small cell lung cancer carcinomas, overall those non-squamous population, and in other histologies with some clinical characteristics like never smokers, like smokers. We have moved from all this population, and we are doing now ALK testing in early stages and locally advanced, since we have immunotherapy and also we have some clinical trials with targeted agents. Regarding the methodology, we started with FISH, then we moved to immunohistochemistry, and now we are using NGS panels. I think it's pretty similar all around the country, not only the population we are testing, but also the methodology we are using in our daily clinical practice.
Great. Charlie?
Okay, so the first is how. So, you know, in China, so FDA had just approved the antenna, IHC and RT-PCR to detect the ALK. So that's the method, this is how. So who were tested with ALK? So in Nafa Hospital, Hunan Cancer Hospital, and every lung cancer patient excluded the small cell lung cancer will receive the detection of ALK by IHC. And, you know, maybe all the patient including the adenocarcinoma and the sarcoma carcinoma, it will both receive the IHC. But if the patient was adenocarcinoma, they will also be detected by the larger panel of NGS. So, so I mean that is who. The third is when to perform the. I want to say that a patient first diagnosed with lung cancer and reveals they will receive the detection for ALK. But if the patient progressed from the ALK TKS, and we will perform the rebiopsy and the mix the rebiopsy and the next generation sequence. So that's all.
So Charlie, Rosario mentioned that she would do all stages because she's now doing PD-L1 testing in the adjuvant setting. Are you just doing advanced stage for ALK testing or other stages?
No. So I want to say that all the patients, maybe they received the surgery in stage 1, 2, 3, they will also receive the detection of antenna IHC. That's the screen. But if the patient will maybe diagnosed with stage 4, and they will also be detected by the NGS. So I mean that.
All right, fantastic. So in the United States, because you know we have multiple different insurers, multiple different states, multiple different practitioners, it's a bit more varied. So I would say next generation sequencing is probably going on in more than 50% of patients now, but there are still some centers when I get second opinions, they've had FISH or they've had immunistic chemistry. And I always wonder whether that's, you know, the pathologist and the medical oncologist haven't really spoken to each other. Who do we test? Well, we are actually a bit like Rosario. We are testing people pretty much from stage 2 onwards. Well, we're testing them when they sort of first come through the door. So let's move on to the second question. So the second question is, you've got an ALK positive patient. Let's assume that they have metastatic disease. Charlie, what is your first line ALK inhibitor? And then what is going to be your second line ALK inhibitor?
Well, so I will treat the patient with clarify by the stage. If this patient was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer, So, you know, the first preferred treatment was alectinib. And, you know, we have another approved drugs called ensartinib, you know, it's X396. Yeah, it's just made in China, it's locally. So that's the first choice. But if the patient progressed with alectinib or the ensartinib, but maybe the second line was clinical trials, we have the lorlatinib and some local drugs. So that's the second line. So that's all.
So Charlie, let me just, so it sounds like you have alectinib and ensartinib equal in your mind. In your own practice, which one do you start a patient on?
No, so I prefer to choose alectinib. So we have the longest PFS, yeah.
Okay, and then Rosario, first and second line ALK inhibitor.
Yeah, that's the big question of the moment. Unfortunately, in Spain, we have just available the conventional first and second, crizotinib, seritinib, and then alectinib and brigatinib. In my practice, I usually start with alectinib or brigatinib, and I think it's basically the same all around the country, although I have to admit that probably alectinib has more penetrance in Spain. We don't have lorlatinib available, so we cannot use in the first line setting, and we keep this drug for those patients who progress after alectinib or brigatinib in the first line setting.
So let me, do you think anyone is starting any patient on crizotinib or seritinib now in your country, Rosario?
I don't think so, to tell you the truth. I think we have enough evidence today, and since we have the other drugs available, I don't think in my country crizotinib is an option, or seritinib because of the adverse events is not an option. I don't think it's a common practice at all.
Okay. And then Charlie, is anyone starting on crizotinib as a first-line treatment in China anymore?
Maybe 2 or 3 years ago, we need to choose crizotinib, but now we have more drugs. So I just want to say, you know, your latest ALK study, just rebiopsy was just approved in China just maybe 3 days ago. So now we have another choice with rebiopsy, but I do not have a lot of experience on these drugs. That's all.
In the United States, we have a lot of drugs. We don't have ensartinib licensed, but we have a lot of the other drugs licensed in the first line setting. In general, in my experience, I still start people on alectinib, even though I did the brigatinib study and the alectinib study. I actually keep brigatinib in reserve as a second line agent off label because I think it's somewhat better tolerated than lorlatinib and has pretty good spectrum of activity. I think alectinib is the dominant drug that most people are starting on in the United States. Second line, a lot of people are using lorlatinib because that's actually on label post alectinib. Although, as I said, I tend to see if I can put in a better tolerated agent in there if possible. Let's move on to a different question at this point. So at some point, you know, we're going to use these ALK inhibitors, but at some point we're going to get to chemotherapy. And so, you know, in that clinical scenario, when you get to chemotherapy, what do you do? Do you do chemotherapy on its own? Do you do chemotherapy with immunotherapy? If you do chemotherapy, do you keep the tyrosine kinase inhibitor going? So I can't remember whose turn it is, but I think it's Charlie's turn to go on this one.
I just want to say that we do have a lot of patients receive the chemo plus bifazomib or chemo plus immunotherapy. So we just mix the detection how to clarify the patient who can benefit from the chemo plus immunotherapy. If we treat the patient with PD-1 inhibitor monotherapy, we cannot have the benefit, but we have more than 70 patients, 70 ALK fusion non-small cell lung cancer. When they failed with the alectinib or other ALK TKI, they also chose chemo plus immunotherapy or chemo plus immunotherapy plus bifazomib just as empower when fixing zero. But we can see that just some of the patients can benefit, maybe the minimum PFS was just 7 months, but we don't know how to choose the better patient to receive the better treatment of immunotherapy. So I just want to hear some suggestions about Rose and IGC.
Well, so I get that, but I want to know what you do. So if the patient is in front of you and they get to chemotherapy, and they say, Dr. Jang, you know, do I go on chemo immunotherapy or chemo keeping the TKI going? What do you say?
I just want to say some evidence. You know, so Professor O just published a paper that if the patient progress from the alectinib, they can just continue to the AVT, but we have the maybe 6 or 5 PFS. But we choose that if we have the more powerful data about empower 150-0. So I will persuade my patient to receive the chemo plus immunotherapy. So I think that if we, in the future, if you progress from the treatment, you can just switch to the former ALK TKI, maybe you can have some benefit. I just want to suggest it for my patient.
All right, hold on. So you're being a little squirrely here. So let me just, so you're saying in your practice, you put people on chemo immunotherapy. That's your first choice. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, Rosaria.
Okay, out of clinical trials, I try to avoid immunotherapy, monotherapy. So the most regimen I use is a combination chemotherapy approach, platinum plus pemetrexed combination, without continuing the tyrosine kinase inhibitor. Regarding the role of schedules like Empower 150, I have some experience, but since we don't have such strong data, it's not the common regimen I use in my daily clinical practice. I hope I have answered.
You have.
Your question.
Well, so I think what we have illustrated is that none of us know the right thing to do. And so, you know, we just do whatever we feel like. And that's totally fine because we don't have good data. You know, in my own practice, first of all, I do believe that pemetrexed has exaggerated activity in ALK positive lung cancer. So I tend to make it a pemetrexed based regime. And then my choice is carboplatin pemetrexed and pembrolizumab or carboplatin pemetrexed and keeping the TKI going. And I don't have any better data than any of the rest of you, but I am not convinced that our PD-1 or PD-L1 agents are really having a lot of benefit in ALK-positive lung cancer. I do worry that in a disease that has a 50% lifetime risk of brain metastases, that removing the TKI leaves the brain vulnerable. So I tend to do carboplatin pemetrexed and keep the TKI going, but I can't prove it's the right thing. So I think this diversity of action reflects our lack of data. All right, so my last group of questions here relates to, sure, we all know that scientifically there are different mechanisms of acquired resistance, on-target ALK mutations, second drivers, but in routine practice, are you rebiopsying, reanalyzing, and acting on that? Rosario, let's start with you.
Okay, yes, definitely. If we can do a rebiopsy, we try to do in all patients who progress after whatever treatment they are receiving. We know that sometimes this information is just relevant from an academic point of view because we cannot make decisions based on that information. But I think it's important to try to figure out what is going on in that patient, in that specific tumors, if there is a histological transformation or whatever. So we try to do it. If we cannot because of the situation of the progression or the disease or because the clinical situation of the patient, we always try to do a liquid biopsy. Yes, I understand that the evidence we have to do so is limited, but in our daily clinical practice, we try to get this information. It's not the same all around the country. That's true also.
Okay.
You know, we are a university center. We are a big center. We have clinical trials. So it's not the same. This is it's controversial all around the country.
Got it. Okay. Charlie.
If you ask me the questions 2 years ago, I can tell you that less than 10% patient with receptor the biopsy when they progressed from the ALK. But now I just want to tell you the new data. We in our center, maybe almost 50% of the patient receives the biopsy for the resistant magnetism. So you know, not all the second or the third generation ALK can cover all the point mutations for resistant magnet. But now we have a lot of the data, but maybe sometimes I can share data for you, Rose. We have a lot of patients. Yeah, we have a lot of patients suffer from the complex recipient magnum sensor 2 or 3 point mutation, but we don't know how to treat this patient.
Okay, so that's good to know. So a couple of questions. So one, this is because, you know, you're in a center that's interested in that. How much, you're saying 50% of your patients are getting rebiopsied and reanalyzed. What do you think that is like across the country?
Frankly, I don't know.
Okay, but I would imagine it would be less.
So why do you think there'll be less? Why do you think that?
Well, because they're not as cutting edge and as interested in the analysis that you are. I suspect you're a local champion for getting this done. The other thing is, when we talked before about how you do the diagnostic testing, you talked about immunohistochemistry and FISH. And in order to make sense of these analyses, you really need to do next generation sequencing.
So I want to say in another cancer center. So for 34 patients, maybe all the patient, all the adenocarcinoma will receive the next generation sequence. But maybe when they progressed from the ALK, maybe samples was unavailable. But I think that we can perform the liquid biopsy. So when I face a patient, my suggestion is that I strongly suggest to the patient, you need to rebiopsy and detect the recipient magnet. So if you can provide me more information, I can give you the better strategy treatment. So I just want to see my patient.
Yeah, I mean, I totally agree with that because, I mean, Rosario had said, you know, this is not, you know, recommended because it's not like there's a drug that we're officially supposed to choose based on the results. And yet, for the patient in front of you, that information can be very useful. I'll give you an example. So, Charlie, you'd mentioned those compound mutations, more than one mutations occurring in cis. And in certain places around the world, there are trials of fourth generation ALK inhibitors. So the Nuvalent drug and the Turning Point drug that can work on those. If you found a patient with a compound mutation, I think it's important to give that information to them so they can seek out these trials if it's feasible for them. But if they don't, then sending them off to go to a fourth generation is a complete waste of their time. And I've had multiple second opinions where somebody has been rebiopsied. They clearly don't have an on-target ALK mutation, and yet they're still sent to these trials and they all blow through it. So even though there isn't a licensed treatment, it's still important to the patient. But I do think you can't just repeat your FISH test and say that's enough. You really need to be looking down and, for ALK mutations and second drivers. All right. That was amazing. It was kind of quick fire. We've covered the entire world in about 20 minutes. Any last comments, any gems that you want to share about managing ALK positive lung cancer? Charlie, we'll let you go first on this.
There was some unknown questions to be answered for the ALK treatment. But if the patient was suffer from ALK fusion, they were lucky. And I think if we collaborated with each other, we can bring lucky to the patient. Thank you.
Oh, I like that. Rosario?
I think that despite all the success we have seen in the last year in this specific subset of non-small cell lung cancer, we have seen in 20 minutes that there is a lot to do. So fully agree, we need more trials, we need more real world data, we need more collaborative efforts to offer the best for this kind of non-small cell lung cancer population.
I agree. And then if I'm going to sum up, if everybody could do what the three people on this call are doing, then the whole field will get better. I mean, the goal isn't to have ivory towers. The goal is to have everybody performing things at the cutting edge. And then you're always at the latest edge of research. You know, what are the next mechanisms of resistance? How do we prolong control? Are there subgroups of ALK who do better or worse that we're going to need to manage separately? But that's all for the future. Thanks for listening.